Hello, my dear students. I am Pratibha Dhaya from the English Lux, and today we will discuss a chapter for student of class 11, Hornbill book, chapter number 1, The Portrait of a Lady, written by Khushwant Singh. Outline of our video is detailed summary, moral. Let's start. Hello students, let's read the story. My grandmother, like everybody's grandmother, was an old woman. She had been old and wrinkled for the 20 years that I had known her. People said that she had once been young and pretty and had even had a husband, but that was hard to believe. Here, author talks about his grandmother. He had known her for the past 20 years, and she had always been old and wrinkled. He was told that she was once young and pretty and had a husband. My grandfather's portrait hung above the mantelpiece in the drawing room. He wore a big turban and loose-fitting clothes. His long white beard covered the best part of his chest, and he looked at least 100 years old. He did not look the sort of person who would have a wife or children. He looked as if he could only have lots and lots of grandchildren. Author told us that his grandfather's portrait hung on the wall, in which he wore loose-fitted clothes, a turban, and had a long white-colored beard that raised his chest. He also appeared very old, and the author thought that he was someone who could have many grandchildren, but not a wife or children. As for my grandmother being young and pretty, the thought was almost revolting. She often told us of the games she used to play as a child that seemed quite absurd and undignified on her part, and we treated it like the fables of the prophets she used to tell us. The author could never imagine that once his grandmother was young and pretty. He could not connect to this idea. She used to tell him and his cousins about her childhood memories, like the games she used to play as a child. They found these stories illogical and disrespectful, because it was beyond their imagination to think that grandmother was once a child and played such games. They thought that her life's stories were like the other moral stories which she used to tell them. She had always been short and fat and slightly bent. Her face was a crisscross of wrinkles running from everywhere to everywhere. No, we were certain she had always been as we had known her. Old, so terribly old that she could not have grown older and had stayed at the same age for 20 years. She could never have been pretty, but she was always beautiful. His grandmother was short, fat, slightly bent in posture, and her face had lot of wrinkles. She seemed so old that she had been the same for the past 20 years. According to the author, she was beautiful, but not pretty. She hobbled about the house in spotless white, with one hand resting on her waist to balance her stoop, and the other telling the beads of her rosary. According to the author, she walked around the house in an awkward way, wearing spotless white clothes with beads of the rosary hanging from one hand, and the other hand rested on her back for support. Her silver locks were scattered untidily over her pale, puckered face. She had silver-colored hair, which was not neatly combed and was disorganized, and her lips constantly moved in inaudible prayers. She was constantly chanting prayers. Yes, she was beautiful. She was like the winter landscape in the mountains. सर्दियों में वह उसकी दादी एक पहाड़ी जमीन जैसी थी. An expanse of pure white serenity, breathing peace and contentment. वह एक शांति और संतुष्टि भरी सांस लेता हुआ शुद्ध सफेद पवित्रता का फैलाव थी. My grandmother and I were good friends. My parents left me with her when they went to live in the city, and we were constantly together. She used to wake me up in the morning and get me ready for school. She said her morning prayers in a monotonous sing-song while she bathed and dressed me in the hope that I would listen and get to know it by heart. तो यहाँ पर जो राइटर है वो बता रहे हैं कि कैसे वो उसको सुबह उठाती थी, रेडी करती थी स्कूल के लिए, और वो जब ये सब काम कर रही होती थी तो अपने एक नीरस से स्वर में, एक नीरस सी, एक मोनोटोनस वॉयस में जो कभी चेंज नहीं होती थी, अपनी मॉर्निंग प्रेयर वो गाती रहती थी. और इस उम्मीद में गाती थी कि राइटर है जो उसे सुनेगा और उसे अच्छे से लर्न कर लेगा. I listened because I loved her voice, but never bothered to learn it. Then she would fetch my wooden slate, which she had already washed and plastered with the yellow chalk, a tiny earthen ink pot and a red pen, tie them all in a bundle and hand it to me. After a breakfast of a thick, stale chapati with a butter, little butter and sugar spread on it, we went to school. She carried several stale chapatis with her for the village dogs. Means he loved her voice but would not try to memorize a word of what she spoke. She would make his things ready like a wooden slate, a tiny earthen ink pot and a red pen. He would eat a thick stale chapati with butter and sugar spread on it. They both used to walk to school and his grandmother carried stale chapatis with her to feed the village dogs. My grandmother always went to school with me because the school was attached to the temple. The priest taught us the alphabet and morning prayer, while the children sat in rows on either side of the veranda, singing the alphabet or the prayer in a chorus. My grandmother sat inside reading the scriptures. When we had both finished, we would walk back together. His grandmother would accompany him to the school as the temple was attached to the school, and she used to visit the temple daily. On one side, he would sit on the veranda with other children, would sing the alphabet and prayer in the chorus. On the other hand, she would sit in the temple to read the scriptures. After finishing, they would back home together. This time, the village dogs would meet us at the temple door. They followed us to our home, growling and fighting with each other for the chapatis we threw to them. When my parents were comfortably settled in the city, they sent for us. The village dogs met them at the temple door. They followed them to their home, growling and fighting with each other for the stale chapatis that she fed them. When his parents got settled in the city, they called them. That was a turning point in our friendship. Although we shared the same room, my grandmother no longer came to school with me. I used to go to an English school in a motor bus. There were no dogs in the streets, and she took to feeding sparrows in the courtyard of our city house. That was the turning point of his friendship with his grandmother. They shared the same room, but she no longer would give him company to his school. He started going to an English medium school, and a motor bus would come to pick and drop him. There were no dogs in the streets whom she could feed as she did in the village. So she started feeding sparrows in the veranda of their house. As the years rolled by, we saw less of each other. For some time, she continued to wake me up and get me ready for school. When I came back, she would ask me what the teacher had taught me. I would tell her English words and little things of Western science and learning, the law of gravity, Archimedes' principle, the world being round, etc. This made her unhappy. She could not help me with my lessons. As the years passed in the city, their interaction reduced. For some time, she continued to wake him up and would get him ready for school. She would ask him what he had learned in school that day. The scientific terminology and English words made her unhappy. As she didn't know the language, she could not help him with the lessons. She did not believe in the things they taught at the English school and was distressed that there was no teaching about God and the scriptures. One day, I announced that we were being given music lessons. She was very disturbed. To her, music had lewd association. It was the monopoly of harlots and beggars and not meant for gentle folk. She said nothing, but her silence meant disapproval. She rarely talked to me after that. As his new school never taught him about God and the religious scriptures, this made her sad. She did not approve of such an education. When she came to know that he was getting music lessons, it disturbed her. According to her, music was indecent and it was an art for the beggars and prostitutes and not for those belong to decent families. She didn't like that he learned music, so she stopped talking to him. When I went up to university, I was given a room of my own. The common link of friendship was snapped. My grandmother accepted her secularism with resignation. She rarely left her spinning wheel to talk to anyone. From sunrise to sunset, she sat by her wheel, spinning and reciting prayers. Only in the afternoon, she relaxed for a while to feed the sparrows. As the author went to university, he had a room of his own. The common link of his friendship with his grandmother that they had when they shared the same room was changed now, and thus his friendship with her ended. She became more private and spent her whole day on spinning wheel. From sunrise to sunset, she would sit and silently recite her prayers. In the afternoon, she used to feed sparrows in the veranda. While she sat in the veranda, breaking the bread into little bits, hundreds of little birds collected round her, creating a veritable bedlam of chirpings. Some came and perched on her legs, others on her shoulders. Some even sat on her head. She smiled, but never shooed them away. It used to be the happiest half hour of the day for her. In the afternoon, she used to feed sparrows in the veranda, breaking the bread into small pieces. She would feed hundreds of birds. The birds would gather around her. Some sat near her, some on her legs, some on her shoulders, and few on her head. She never shooed them, but always smiled. She was the happiest in that half an hour during the whole day. When I decided to go abroad for further studies, I was sure my grandmother would be upset. I would be away for 5 years, and at her age, one could never tell. But my grandmother could. She was not even sentimental. She came to leave me at this railway station, but did not talk or show any emotion. Her lips moved in prayer. Her mind was lost in prayer. When the author decided to go abroad for further studies, he believed it would be the last time he would see her, as he would be gone for 5 long years. Her fingers were busy telling the beads of her rosary. Silently, she kissed my forehead, and when I left, I cherished the moist imprint as perhaps the last sign of physical contact between us. But that was not so. After 5 years, I came back home and was met by her at the station. As they all reached the station, she held him tightly and kissed his forehead. He thought it was the last physical contact with her. The wet impression of his forehead was dear to him. She was not sentimental at all. When he came back after 5 years, she came to meet him at the station. She did not look a day older. She still had no time for words. And while she clasped me in her arms, I could hear her reciting her prayers. Even on the first day of my arrival, her happiest moments were with her sparrows, whom she fed longer, and with frivolous rebukes. She looked just the way she did 5 years ago, not a day older. She held him again in her arms and was still reciting her prayers. He noticed on the first day of his arrival that only sparrows would make her happy. In the evening, a change came over her. She did not pray. She collected the women of the neighborhood, got an old drum, and started to sing. For several hours, she thumped the shaking skin of the dilapidated drum and sang of the homecoming of warriors. We had to persuade her to stop to avoid overstraining. An evening, she didn't follow her regular routine of praying. She collected a few women from the neighborhood, got a drum, and started singing with them. She thumped the ruined part of the drum and sang along. The whole family persuaded her to stop, as she might get ill due to exhaustion. That was the first time since I had known her that she did not pray. The next morning, she was taken ill. It was a mild fever, and the doctor told us that it would go. But my grandmother thought differently. She told us that her end was near. She said that since only a few hours before the close of the last chapter of her life, she had omitted to pray. She was not going to waste any more time talking to us. The next morning, she fell ill. It was a mild fever. The doctor told them that it would go away, but she took it differently. According to her, she would die soon as her end was near. She started chanting prayers as she didn't want to waste her last hour in talking to anyone. We protested, but she ignored our protest. She lay peacefully in her bed, praying and telling her beads. Even before we could suspect, her lips stopped moving and the rosary fell from her lifeless fingers. A peaceful pallor spread on her face, and we knew that she was dead. The family protested, tried to stop her, but she lay peacefully on her bed, chanting prayers and doing her beads. Suddenly, she stopped and the rosary fell from her lifeless fingers. A calm, pale appearance spread on her face and she was dead. We lifted her off the bed and, as is customary, laid her on the ground and covered her with a red shroud. The family lifted her from the bed, laid her on the ground and covered her with a red colored cloth. After a few hours of mourning, we left her alone to make arrangements for her funeral. In the evening, we went to her room with a crude stretcher to take her to be cremated. The sun was setting and had lit her room and veranda with a blaze of golden light. We stopped halfway in the courtyard, all over the veranda and in her room, right up to where she lay dead and stiff, wrapped in the red shroud. Thousands of sparrows sat scattered on the floor. There was no chirpings. We felt sorry for the birds, and my mother fetched some bread for them. She broke it into little crumbs, the way my grandmother used to, and threw it to them. The sparrows took no notice of the bread. When we carried my grandmother's corpse off, they flew away quietly. Next morning, the sweeper swept the breadcrumbs into the dustbin. Here, author wants to tell us that thousands of sparrows sat silently near her. The author's mother fetched some bread for the birds, but they didn't eat any. They flew away later as the family carried the dead body of grandmother. The sweeper removed the crumbs the next morning. The birds were so sensitive. They did not want to eat bread, but were mourning the death of the one who had fed them for so many days. So, my dear student, in this story, author wants to tell us about the relationship between humans and birds. The story put highlights on the need of companionship and friendship felt by our elders. This we come to end of this story, a very touching story of the relationship of the writer and her grandmother. I hope you like the lesson very much. Thank you for watching this video. For many more such stories, please subscribe to our channel, The English Lux. Make sure, if you have any suggestion and comments, feel free to write in the comment section. And for more and more videos, like and subscribe my channel, The English Lux, your key to English. And don't forget to hit the bell icon.